I'm glad to be here in Torah Or in Los Angeles. Thank you for coming. We will speak about several different topics as we announce. We will speak about the situation in the world today, where we're heading to according to the Torah and the prophets, and also Jewish common sense. As you know, in the last year and a half to 2 years, the world started to have a financial crisis. Even though it's only financial, it could have been worse things. Financial is related to almost everything. It relates to wars, to security of countries. When the economy of countries are doing very bad, it leads usually to horrible wars. If you look at the history, when countries cannot maintain their bills and cannot function in economy, it leads them to go into a war. War usually improves the economy. It gives more jobs, they spend more money, they print more money. This is the situation. In perhaps in the history of the world, there was no crisis that the future looked so bad. We still didn't get to the worst of it, even though on the news they say the situation getting better, we see indications that business becoming better, and the future looks better. But this is, if you're really honest with yourself and you really see the picture, you see that they're dreaming. It's not getting better, it's getting a lot worse. Why in the last 6-7 months it seems that the economy gets better? Why? Of course, the government printed more than $1 trillion and gave it out. The government buy all the bad business from all the banks. If the government wouldn't do it, you wouldn't have one bank left in America. All the major banks, Citibank, Bank of America, they all were a month before bankruptcy. Citibank almost went to zero, the stock. Other banks went to $3, $7. In history, they don't remember such a thing. One more month the government would wait, people will kill one another here on the streets today if they didn't do what they do. But now you're paying the price for it. What's the price? The dollar goes to zero. Everywhere in the world, the dollar is going down. What happened? Okay, big deal. So the dollar used to be 4.5 shekel. Now it's 3.6 something. Soon it's going to be 2.5. And the next thing, it's going to be 1 shekel. So what's the problem? The problem is, when the currency of the country goes down, foreigners from overseas come and buy all over the United States. It won't be United States of America. It will be United States of Saudi Arabia. Why? Their money worth a lot of money. They have oil. They come, they buy buildings here for peanuts. It's nothing for them. In the price of what used to be one building, they buy 15. Already now, one Arab person owned 7% of United States. One person. 7% of the economy of United States in the hand of one person, Sheikh Bandar. Do you know that? When he comes to America, they have 100 FBI cars and police around him. They close streets in Manhattan. He is controlling this country in one phone call. Whatever he wants happens here. Why? God forbid if he decides to take his investment out of America, what would happen? Also, everything you see in America, all this phony wealth, it's all Chinese money, Japanese money, Arab money. It's not American money. All these countries put trillions and trillions of dollars constantly in the United States economy. All you need is that tomorrow China will say we want all our money back and America is completely finished, bankrupt. Remember what happened in Argentina 10 years ago, 8 years ago? Yesterday you went to sleep, you had $100 million. Let's see, you're the richest guy in Argentina. You woke up in the morning, your $100 million became $20,000. Finished. Everything became zero. People couldn't take money out of their checking accounts, saving accounts. Trucks full of money and gold were crossing the borders. They're smuggling it out of Argentina. Everybody steal whatever they can. Tellers in the bank steal anything they can from their customer, put it on a truck and leave. Why? The country collapsed. It happens in Russia. The United States is not bigger than Russia. Russia is a rich country. You went to sleep with $100 million, you woke up in the morning with $20,000. The ruble from 5 went to 500 overnight. That's what happened. Now, the Torah already prepared us, the Jews, that before the Mashiach come, there will be time that all the millionaires and the rich people will all be broke. They'll lose everything. And we already see it. I myself know more than 100 millionaires and billionaires in a Jewish world that in a period of 3 to 6 months lost everything. Few of them, hard to believe. These people were on worth hundreds of millions, and all of a sudden you hear they need money for Shabbos, from Tomchei Shabbos. Can you believe such a thing? 2 months ago I was giving $100 bill, one after the other, to people, giving out money. 6 months later, one bad investment, real estate all collapsed. All of a sudden he needs money for Shabbat. Just today on my way here, I got a phone call. There's a guy in New York that owns tons of real estate. But he need right away $100,000. If not, the bank put a lien of all his properties and he's bankrupt, he's finished. If he won't get $100,000 in 2 weeks, all the tens of millions of dollars real estate that he have will all become nothing. Why? It's the beginning of the crash. And you know how many people like this you have? Now, I want to ask you a question. For those of you who are here in America for many years, there was about 7, 8 good years in business. Now we understand, when we look retroactive, that it was all an illusion. What happened? I'll give you an example how it works. Now, I didn't come here to speak about economy. Soon I'm going to go into the religion, into Judaism, to see why all these things are happening to us. But first, let's understand what really happened. Most people are living in a dream. They don't understand how bad is the situation. People have an average house in America was between $150,000 to $250,000. You know, we are here in Beverly Hills, and you have houses of $10, $20 million. We're not talking about this. This is special. But most of the Americans had houses between $150,000 to $250,000. I remember 10 years ago, 7 bedrooms was $250,000. Today, you couldn't, well, a year ago, you couldn't get it for $1 million. Everything became 4 times more. But did real estate really worth more? No. It was all a balloon. Balloon. I have this. It's worth $1. I'm beginning to convince people that I want $2 for it. It's special. You won't be able to get it. Soon it's going to be out of the market. Business is booming. All of a sudden, somebody offered me $120, $130, $150, $160. In a period of 1 year, this doubled its price. Then a year later, it became 3 times more. Houses that was 200, all of a sudden became 850, all over the United States. The American people, we became rich, doing nothing. We were still working. Now we worked 4 times more than a year ago, or 2 years ago. What did they do? The nature of the people is to get pleasure. People are always searching for pleasure. Cars, clothing, food, vacations. Look at the world, what people are doing for pleasure. The people started to take loans. Every person in America became a business person. Takes a loan from the bank on his house. The house now worth a lot. The bank were very generous, giving loans to everyone with no credit, with credit, whatever. They give. They want to make money. People bought more properties, they do renovation, every other person became a real estate builder, and came the crash. Everything went back to what it's really worth, and it's on the way down now. Somebody just told me, here, a house that was $800,000 was sold for $600,000 a year ago, and now $500,000 they can get, which means in 1 year it went from $800,000 to $500,000. You know what we're talking here about? 40% less in 1 year. And it's going to go a lot less, a lot less. Now, all these people that took loans cannot pay the loans. They had five-year special rate. Now the rate became a lot higher. They can't pay the loans. So they default on the loans. The bank lost billions of dollars every month from all over in one shot. The bank said to the government, if you let us go down, this country is finished. It's not going to be, you cannot put money in a checking account. You cannot write a check. There's no system here. The government came out and said there are 19 banks. We are committed to keep them in business, no matter what it takes. All the 19 major banks. But the government bought all the bad loans from them that people don't pay. So the government took the building. They have the the building, somebody owe money on it. It doesn't pay. So the government gave them hundreds of billions to the banks to keep them in business. And these banks, which are the biggest crooks in the whole world, they come now on the media, on the stock market every quarter and say, this is the second quarter that business is booming. We are very profitable. Of course you are very profitable. The government took $500 billion damage from you. They took it to the American money, the people who pay the taxes, gonna have to pay for what the bank lost. When they made money, nobody gave money to the Americans. When the bank lost money, the American people will have to pay it in 100 years, if ever. So the United States owe more money every day. Soon, they'll tell China, we're very sorry, we can't pay you what you owe you. We just can't, we don't have the money. If we continue to print, 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 the dollar will be a penny. We're not going to be able to buy anything from overseas. We'll be finished here. What? House will worth $2,000 if that's going to continue to happen. You would like to buy screws from China, you'll have to mortgage your car. It's going to be a disaster. So what happened, you think, when the Russians and the Arabs and the Chinese will find out that all their investment, all their saving of the last 50 years became mud? You think the 2 billion Chinese will say, thank you, America? Who knows what's going to be? Now, when this has happened, America is the heart of the world. It's not only a country, an empire. It's affecting every other economy. It's already affecting Europe, affecting other countries. Who really paid the price in a country that used to be in power and now they're on the way down? Who are the first one that always paid the price? The Jews. For a few reasons. Anti-Semitism was always exists. Well, no matter when, the Jew is rich, the Jew is poor, the Jew is beautiful, the Jew is ugly, the Jew is smart, the Jew is not so smart, the Jew is pretty, whatever it is. The Jews is always their fault. On top of that, in every country that the Jews were sitting, they have the key jobs. The presidents, the heads of the banks, the head of the insurance company, the head of the advertisement, they control the media. It's true, it's not a lie. The Jews are very talented people and they have the blessing of God that everything they're going to leave, they'll be as a shining diamond. So when the goyim cannot put food on the table, who do they blame? The people who are in charge. Especially when they're not exactly crazy about them. Who is the one who makes the interest rate goes up and down? A Jew. Who is the advisor of the treasury? The Jew. Who is the judge that evicts the goy from his home? Most likely a Jew. Who is the lawyer that sends him the papers to leave his property? It's also a Jew. Who is the one who speaks on the news and talk about the situation? Another Jew. That's what they look at. On top of that, show them all what they show from Israel with the media, pictures, they fake Israeli soldiers, they show Arab kids, terrorists are crying. How long are we going to last like this? It's a miracle. The Gemara says, Kivsa achad ben shivim zevim, one sheep between 70 wolves. Every second we're alive, it's a big miracle. Every second. We have to be fools not to see it. Hard to believe. You know, in New York, when they caught some Syrians and some of the rabbis, they started to make a story, money laundering, this, that, all nonsense. If you really see what they did, it's really nothing. Rabbis from Israel came to America. They wanted to collect charity. The people who wanted to give them charity, they asked them, do you have a non-profit organization here in America that I can deduct it from my taxes that I'm giving charity? They said, no, we're from Israel. But we have somebody that's willing to give us a non-profit account. Write it to XYZ organization. So they wrote it to an American that is in Brooklyn or in New York. They wrote a check to American organization. The American organization cashed the check and took the cash and gave it to that rabbi to take it to his yeshiva. That's it. It's against the law in America because the IRS in America are willing to give you tax discount if you give charity in America, not overseas. Fine. So they did a violation. What is the big deal? They describe it as like it's a genocide or something. Show the rabbis on the news with handcuffs and this and that. Guess what happened a week after in Deal, New Jersey? That's where all the Syrian lives. The goyim were driving the cars and screaming, get out of here, you don't belong here. That's what happened a week later. And you know what the problem is? That if the FBI catch 10 Jews that did something wrong, especially in the religious community, everyone is connected to everyone. It leads them to 100. Every little thing, whoops, this guy, handcuffs. This guy, FBI, federal, jail, hundreds already receive all kinds of papers. They're under investigation, they're questioning them. They're all depressed. It's his brother, it's his cousin, it's his father-in-law, it's his son. You know what's going to happen when they come on the news, God forbid, and say hundreds of people are arrested because of this and because of that? We're not going to be able to walk here in the street. In France, it's a life risk to walk with the yarmulke. Every day you walk in France with the yarmulke, you have to say Birkat HaGomel. Why? 5 million Arabs took over France. 5 million fanatic Muslims. Walking in Paris, everywhere you go, they scream, they curse, they attack, they murder one Jew, a salesman in a store. He came, he stabbed him in front of everyone, kill him, no problem. On a subway, on a metro. Jews are escaping from France. You know why the real estate goes up in Israel? In Israel, the economy is horrible. There's no jobs, unemployment. It's never been good. Now it's one of the worst times, but it goes up. Why all the Americans and the French are coming to Israel and they buy everything, so the real estate goes up. But it's all a balloon. This is all a balloon. Same thing the stock market. Can you find one reason why the stock market, after it crashed, all of a sudden going up? What, the economy gets any better? There's more unemployed people. There's more problem in Afghanistan. There's more problems in Iraq. The dollar is going down. Half of the company fire almost everyone. Here, just my friend told me here that he's working for a company, and all the lawyers, even the lawyers, people give them checks, the checks bounce. The lawyers in America. The lawyers cannot receive checks. Why? Criminals that needs defense cannot afford to pay even $1,000 check. That's what's happening now. Now, they don't show you in the news the real picture. They say business is signs, we're going out of depression. The truth is, we're not going out of depression. How do I know? I speak to thousands of people every year, thousands. Emails, talking after the lecture, in between, all the time, around the club. Every person I speak to, I can count on one hand how many of them told him, Baruch Hashem, we make a living. Every person I speak to cry about his parnasa. So how is the economy getting better? If I spoke to thousands of people in the last year, I don't remember 5 that say we okay. 5 even. So how is getting better? I see by myself. I used to go to lectures a year and a half ago. I used to put hundreds of CDs. I tell the people it costs me $1 to make. Just cover your costs. It's not for profit. That we can do another bunch. You put hundreds of CD, you get $60, $30. From wealthy communities, they can afford to give $2-$3 donations. How can it be? It used to be much better. Somebody used to take 1 or 2, give 20. Didn't care. Today, it will take 20, give 2. It's the opposite. Why? Everybody counts the pennies. There are people in New York, they don't go to work. They can't afford the gas and the tolls. $18 a day tolls, $20 gas. Problems with the car here and there, it doesn't pay. How much they make after taxes? This is the situation. I speak to these people. Every other person who calls me, how are you doing? I'm looking for a job already for a year, for 6 months. I can't find a job. I have nothing to eat. I'm collecting some money from the government. This is the situation. Now, just in Israel, when the real estate collapses, who knows what's going to be there? Because Israel is always a year after America. You feel it there later. It takes time. All the American companies order from Israel. Now they don't order. It takes a year until they realize there. אין לנו על מי לסמוך, אלא על אבינו שבשמיים. In this situation, when everything looks black or gray, we only have one solution. That's it. out of desperation, if you may call it like that. We have to scream to Hashem in our situation. And this is exactly what HaKadosh Baruch Hu planned for us. I want to ask you a question. Let's be honest. When do people have more time to dedicate for God? When they loaded with millions of dollars coming from all over and they're not worried about tomorrow? Or when they don't know if tomorrow they can pay the rent or the mortgage? When? When they scream, God help me, I'm begging. When?
They can't pay the mortgage.
When they can't pay the mortgage. When they sick. There's hardly any Jewish family that can raise their hand and say, we're lucky, we don't have any sick in our family. It's an epidemic. Every 5 minutes, pray for this boy with cancer, pray for this woman, pray for this guy. I get hundreds of these text messages. Pray for this, pray for that, heart attack, problem, stroke, coma. You don't even digest the news. 10 minutes later, another one, and another one, and another. You wake up in the morning, there's already 8 cancer things every day. Coincidence? It used to be heart attacks was the number one killer. Now they just recently announced that cancer is more. One out of 9 women in America has breast cancer. Can you believe such a thing? You see 10 women walking on the street, one of them is about or already had or will have breast cancer, which if they don't catch it on time, it spread to the rest of the body. Problems, heart attacks, people dying out of pain in the heart when they lose money. A person that had $10 million and he lost 5 is still in a very good condition compared to most people in America, but he doesn't see it that way. The nature of the person is not to see what you have right now, what you had or what you could have had. And because the person is greedy and his eyes is always searching for more, when he loses something, this something can kill him. You know how many people committed suicide because they lost in the stock market a lot of money? But overall, when they check how much they have left, they're still better than 99% of us. So why they kill themselves? Because they lost $20 million. But they still have 60. The 20 million killed them, how they lost it. They killed themselves. Not one, not two. This is the situation. So Hashem is doing it for us for one reason. Because the Gemara say, En ben David ba, ad shelo tichle pruta min hakis. One of the signs you're going to see before Mashiach come, that people will be completely broke. They drive a Mercedes and now they cannot afford the gas. That's it, it happens. People that have fancy cars in New York take the subway. They can't afford to take the car and put it in a parking. That's the situation. I don't remember something like this. Reviewing the history, there's always hard times in the world. It's not the first time. But when you see where the world is heading to, with all the terrorism and the threat and what's going to happen with Iran, who knows? Who knows? We don't really know. The anti-Semitism is a big threat for us. You should know that. In Israel, it used to be a safe place. Not anymore. Why? The government of Israel saw that there is a lot of Jews who are making tshuva and they're becoming religious. What happened when close to 1 million Jews became Shomer Shabbos in the last 20 years? It's a big threat for the secular Jews. They can't afford that from 120 members in the Knesset, 40, 50 of them will be religious. It's going to be the end of them. Because everything they want to pass, 50 beard and peos raising their hand, objection, we don't want. We don't want pork. Close all the pork stores in Israel. We don't want transportation on Shabbat. We don't want this. We don't want that. We want to change the rules in the army. We want the soldiers, the girls, to dress modestly, not the way they are. It will interfere with their lifestyle. They don't want. So what do? They imported 1 million immigrants, 800,000 of them Russian goyim. The Russians, based on our tradition, the Germans, the French, the Russians, this is all descendants of Amalek. Amalek, Esav, Amalek. They're not exactly crazy about the Jews if you check the history, how much we suffer from them. Even now, almost all the problems we had from the Arabs, it's the Russians' fault. Without the Russians, the Arab couldn't do anything. The Arab couldn't fly a plane without the Russians. They taught them everything they know about tanks, about weapons. And the last war with the Hezbollah, that the Israeli army lost to the Hezbollah, Russian weapon, the most advanced weapon, they were bombing the tanks. The Israeli didn't know where it comes from. A terrorist holding with a special missile, he shoot the tank, boom, the tank splits open. More than 30 tanks, they blew up like this. A boat, $2 billion, the boat cost, with all the most advanced equipment, a very expensive, huge boat with all the weapon you can think of. It can carry atomic missiles, submarine, whatever it is. The Hezbollah blew it up with Russian weapon. Who gives the money? Who lend the money? Who give up? They give up whatever they owe them. They don't pay them, no problem. Let's start fresh. It's going on like this. And again and again and again. Who gave Iran what they have? Without Russia, Iran had something? The Russians don't care. They'll help them to get a bomb. 800,000 of this righteous Russian came to Israel. I don't know if you're visiting a lot in Israel, but 20 years ago, you didn't have almost in the entire country of Israel maybe 5 stores that sell pork. It was like trying to get drugs underground. That's how difficult it was. Every corner in cities, Tel Aviv, Bat Yam, you have supermarkets with big signs in Russian, pork, this, that, all porks. They have cemeteries with crosses all over Israel now. In Christmas, you drive in the night of Christmas in Israel, in Jaffa, in other cities, full of lights in the terrace. Lights, Christmas lights in Israel. They already found in Israel Russian Nazis. They put them on the news, Nazis, with swastikas in Israel. Why they brought them? They thought they will help us against the religious people. You understand what's going on here? Now, here is where the problem begins. Some of these Russians became Israelis. They're okay, they're not threat, supposedly, to society. They go to work, they clean, some of them teachers, doctors, whatever. There's only one problem. According to the Torah, if a Jew marry a non-Jewish woman, the kids are goyim, even if they're very nice. These kids of all these Russian ladies, they're all goyim. They don't even know it. They go to elementary school in Israel. Her name is Miriam, Hana, Rachel. They have Israeli names. They grew up in Israel with Israeli accent. 20 years later, nobody even remembered that his father was an Amalek or her mother. Nobody remembers. She's Israeli. He's going to meet her in the army and marry her. And the kids will be Amalek in Israel. Not 10 or 20,000. Hundreds of thousands of them. Our children will end up with them. This is a spiritual end to our society. Why they did it? To get more in the elections. It's going to be not religious government. God forbid. Now, why are they afraid the most? That the religious people in Israel, they don't go to the army. So if they won't go to the army, who's going to fight? They're right, no? What is it like? In Mexico, it used to be a bridge. One time there was something happened, the bridge collapsed a little bit, and there was a hole in the middle of the bridge. So every car that passed by fell into the hole and fell into the river underneath. The ocean. So the city of Mexico, I just chose Mexico, it can be anywhere, just for the story. The city of Mexico, they had an urgent meeting. What to do with the problem? People are falling into the water. So they decided to build a hospital right underneath to send boats and rescue the people. What do you think about their advice? What do you think? What do you think about it? Smart or no? What would be better? Block the bridge. Fix the problem. They drive on Shabbat. They eat pork. They still in a business. They have naked girls all over Israel. They have dirty services in the newspaper. They have all the sins you can imagine every minute all over Israel. They bring all the Arabs to attack us day after day, as the Torah says, when you don't listen to me, I send your enemies to attack you, God says. But when you're faithful to me, I will protect you from all your enemies. I will fight for you. Don't worry. Sit still. Do nothing, the Torah says. They bring all the problems to us, to those who keep the mitzvot, and then they say, why you don't come to the army? You understand what's going on? It's like a tenant is renting a house from a landlord. He break up the whole house and he scream at the landlord, why you don't come to help me fix? That's what it's like. Why I have to go to the army? To protect you from the Arabs. Why the Arabs are coming? Because you drive on Shabbat. You annul the covenant with God. Didn't you read in the Torah? So what's their answer? Come on, don't tell me this nonsense. I don't even believe in this Torah. So you invite them. Okay, no problem. Let's have a debate. It takes me 10 minutes to prove anybody you bring me that the Torah is divine. Put a judge, 10 minutes. Believe me, I had arguments with some smart people. Among them, the state controller of New York State. Good enough for you? Trillions of dollars under his signature every year. The whole New York State under his signature. The unions, the highways, the schools, the politicians, everything. You can see the debate that I had with him in my website, in English. And he's also professor for history. What happened in the end? 45 minutes, he argued with me in the lecture. I answered all his questions. It was very sharp, I have to say. And then in the end, I said, Mr. Avesi, what do you think? He said, I still have some doubts. What a tremendous improvement. In the beginning of the lecture, he was a complete atheist. He came to see what this fool has to say. That's the approach he came with. 45 minutes of arguments in a 2 hour lecture. He was impressed. He said, I still have some doubts. What an improvement. I said, okay, let's sit one-on-one. You willing? I said, yeah, why not? About 10 days later, we met. 3 hours. He asked, I answer. He asked, and in the end, he said, 100%. Impossible to deny. So I said, so what are you going to do? Listen, I'm 68 years old. It's hard for me. Where will I start right now? Toda. Where will I start right now? You understand? That's the problem that we have. Finally, you prove! No? How many of those people who saw the Torah is divine begin to live according to the Torah? Toda rabba. Baruch atah Adonai, Elohim melech haolam, shakom yevdvaro. How many? I just proved to 10 Jews that the Torah is divine. How many of them tomorrow will put tefillin? If we're lucky, 3. If we're lucky. What happened to the other 7? Went back to their lies. A person is a chronological liar.
It's not comfortable for them.
I know. Nothing is comfortable. Nothing is comfortable. To go to the doctor and pay him $1,000 to check you because you suspect you have something is comfortable? Just worked a week for that $1,000. You go to him 20 minutes, $1,000 for the checkup. I once took my brother, he broke his arm, to the emergency room. We were sitting for 3 hours. We were one of the first one on the list. They don't even call his name. Everybody comes after, he goes in. What's going on here? 3 hours, he's dying from pain. Then the doctor came out. Oh, he's on the way home. So I said to the woman there, what's going on? We're here in the first on the list. So, oh, yeah, we didn't call you, I'm sorry. Okay, you have to come tomorrow. He has a broken arm, he's swollen, all blue and red. I said to the doctor, excuse me, you're not living here. We are 3 years here. I'm sorry, I'm in Iran. I'm sorry, you have to check him. What's the problem? He broke his arm. Let me see. Okay, listen, put your arm up on a pillow. Don't worry, everything will be fine. Guess how much was the bill for that? No. About 11 years ago it was. Guess how much was the bill for that we received? No. $1,450. He's charging us for that. Yes. And when I call him to ask him, why you charge such a price for 5 seconds? He said, you know how much I pay for my school? For my student loans and for the years that I went to medical school? Do you think he doesn't have a point? He has a point. You know why? Because the colleges in America, besides the bank, is the biggest corrupted institutions in history. Nobody ever did such a thing like they did. It's a one complete mafia with the government. You want to get education, you have to go bankrupt. You want to send the kids to college, you have to work 10 years to pay for it. Yes, that's what's going on here. Students, this. And most of the students, in the end, they become nothing. They drive a taxi. What do you think? Everybody becomes a lawyer, a successful lawyer. And if he became a lawyer, you know how many unemployed cannot make a living? I met one time a lawyer, very talented Jew, out of law school, has all the skills. He went, they offered him $33,000 to start, 7 years ago in Manhattan, when they pay good. When he told me the price, I told him after he spent $300,000 for college and law school, this is what you're gonna make? When are you gonna pay back? His parents pay for it, of course. You understand? Now, between me and you, let's be honest. I'm trying to be honest. Maybe I make mistakes, but believe me, it's not intentional. Let's be honest. To become a dentist, just to become a good dentist, how many months you need to learn? Maximum, if you're a moron, 6 months. How do I know? A great dentist told me, you stand by me 3 months, I make you a better dentist than me. It's all nonsense. Why do you have to go years? It's a way to get money out of the people. Why a dentist has to know history? Why he has to know math? He has to know how to be a good dentist to fix the teeth and the root canals. That's it. Why they push so much to learn? Money, business, everyone eats. Very good. To be a lawyer, learn the law, learn the constitution. If you're a sharp guy and you know all the laws, you know how to defend your clients. You need to know art history, you need to know math, you need to know all this. No, you don't need. 99% of what they learn in college, a week later they don't remember. Think they remember? You think that the lawyers remember the laws? I once went to do a real estate deal with a lawyer. I asked him, did you go over the contracts? He said, don't worry, Mr. Mizrahi, everything is fine. And this is a religious lawyer. So I look at the pages, not that I'm an expert in contracts, real estate, there's a lot of tricky words. But then I see in a contract, subject to rent control. It sounded scary. I asked him, what is this? He looks at that. I saw right away, Baruch Hashem, I have this gift from Hashem that as soon as the person makes a move, I get the feeling what is going through his mind. So I saw right away he got nervous, but he was trying to hide it. No, don't worry, it's nothing. Believe me, I checked everything. But my intuition already told me that something is fishy here. I asked the title company guy, can you step out with me for 1 second? He's not representing me. He was sent by the state to do the title company. From the title company, he comes out with me to the hallway. I took out $50, I put in his hand. That's about 9 years ago, 8 years ago. I said, please tell me, what is this? He told me, that means if you sign the contract and one of the tenants that live here all the years will complain against you to the authorities, you will have to pay all the tenants of this building retroactive from the minute they moved into the building 1.5 times of the rent of all the years, which means over $1 million damage for a $140,000 deal. That's what it means. You think they know the rules? Maybe he knew and he was trying to drown me just to save himself the shame that he didn't even read the contract. Do you think the accountants know all the laws? Almost every question I asked my accountant over the years, he didn't know the answer, and he's 40 years an accountant and a sharp guy. They don't know. That's why they have the books. I'll get back to you in 10 minutes. You think the rabbis know all the laws? What do you think? Every rabbi, you call him and you ask him a hard question. I have a cousin like this, but there's 1 to 1 million. You can find somebody. Like every question you ask him from any subject, at any time, he gives you the answer with all the sources by heart. How many like this you have? 20 in the whole world, maybe? Most rabbis, some of the routine questions they know. When there's a hard question coming, they say, I'll call you back with the answer. Sometimes it takes them a week to find the answers. You know, this reminds me about a great story. You know, I give a lot of lectures for Kiruv, Hebrew and English. One time I gave a lecture for Israelis in a real estate office during the day. I used to give lectures there every Friday. And the people from the office slowly, slowly becoming religious. There was one very intelligent girl with education from Israel. She's working there in the office. And she started to get involved with Judaism. She reads books now. She's already considering to keep Shabbat. For somebody like her, it's a miracle. Then I saw, you know, we have a say in Hebrew, when the she'abarzel cham kal lekofef oto. When the metal is hot, it's very easy to bend it the way you want. Once it gets cold, you cannot move it anymore. She's now inspired. I thought maybe I'll invite her with all this group for Shabbat. We'll give them Shabbaton, and Bezrat Hashem, they see what a place we live in Monsi. It's a paradise. 50,000 Orthodox religious Jews. You don't find anybody secular there. No Goyim, no secular. All religious people from all kinds. Ashkenazi, Sfaradi, Hasidi, Yemenite, anything you can think of. Modern Orthodox. So she came to Monsi. You can see how she's enjoying every minute. You know, Divrei Torah and the Shabbos table. Then I made the mistake of my life. What was the mistake of my life? You know, in Israel, the media brainwashed the people constantly against religion. They don't have it in America. They're not admiring religion, but they're not constantly speaking against it on the news. So I said, Rabbi Ovadia Yosef said. That's all I said. She looked at me. Her smile disappeared. What? This is your hero? She hears on the news all the time against him. He's the chief rabbi of the Sfaradim in the world. I said, what's the problem? She said, I'm very disappointed. I thought you're more intelligent, sophisticated. What do you have to do with him? She tells me. So I told her, I want to ask you a question. Who is the smartest Jew you know? She said, Professor Aharon Barak, the head of the Israeli Supreme Court. It's a very famous judge all over the world. You know, he wrote books. He's teaching in Harvard. So he's a very smart guy, supposedly. What's the problem? The echo? What? So I say, okay, so he's the smartest guy? Okay, good. I want to ask you a question. What happened if I send him a question? What is the question? Two neighbors are fighting about legal issues. Two. And because of that, one of the neighbors wants, you know, this, the other neighbor wants this. Now the judge has to decide who is right. Would he be able to tell me the history of that question for the last 1,000 years? I'm asking him a question, the judge. Will he be able to tell me the answer plus all the history of the last 1,000 years in all the courts? What was the answer of all the judges in regards to this question? She told me, of course not. He's not supposed to know the history of the court. That's why they have archives, they have books, and today it's all computerized, she tells me. So, okay, very good. I agree with you. He doesn't know. He only may be able to tell me the answer. So I ask her, what would I tell you? Come. She was sitting on the other side of the table. Come over. You see these books? I told her, please take out one. She picked one of the books out and said, this is the book of Rabbi Ovadia Yosef. When 30, 40 years ago, when he was in his 40s, he was a rabbi, he was sitting. Then in those days, there was only two channels on the radio in Israel, Reshet Aleph and Reshet Bet. So he was sitting in the radio on Friday morning or afternoon. People are calling live with the hardest question in Judaism. Hardest. Question that almost nobody knows. You don't find the answer anywhere. They call and ask him. And who are the callers? A lot of them were big rabbis themselves that don't know. So they call and he answered them. And the radio host, every few minutes, come on the air and say, Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that the 15 minutes that the rabbi was answering was all by heart. We don't have books here in the studio. This is a live show, and we don't know the questions in advance. Because he couldn't believe. It was a religious host. He couldn't believe what he saw. They recorded those shows, and they printed a book. What's the name of the book? I'm sure you have it here. Yachaveh Da'at, Questions and Answers by Rabbi Ovadia Yosef. So I told her, open. Open whenever you want. Open. She opened the book. I said, okay, here is a question. What question, she asked. Are Jews allowed to step in the land of Egypt? Where the question come from? The Torah says that after the Jews left Egypt, they never will see Egypt ever again. That's what the Torah says. Now we have few doubts. What did God mean? That the Jews of that generation are not allowed to return to Egypt, or the Jews until the end of the world? What Egypt he was referring to? The ancient Egyptians? Those who lived in the time of Pharaoh, or anybody who would live in Egypt? Because today in Egypt you have the descendants of Ishmael. You don't have Pharaoh and his nation. They already got mixed in the world. There used to be a king named Sancheriv. He made revolution all over the world. He changed all the nations. He got them all mixed. He threw them to exile. It was a big problem. So the Egyptians today are simply Arabs. They have nothing to do with Pharaoh. Same thing the Palestinians. They're not the Philistines like something. They named themselves after the people who used to be in Gaza, the Philistines. It's a different nation. So the next doubt is, what is the next doubt? What did the Torah mean? To come back there to live? Or even as a visit, you're not allowed? Who is asking the question? A newspaper reporter that he is religious and he wants to go to interview Anwar Sadat that came to Israel to make peace with Begin, if you remember what the peace agreement. Okay, so he wants to know if he's allowed to go to Egypt. There's a lot of doubts here. It's not such a simple question. So I told her, let's see how many sources the Rav was giving him by heart. We started to count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20. When we got to 50, I said, what do you mean by heart? All these quotes that he said was all by heart? This book, this chapter, this page, this rabbi. And by the way, he's telling the life story of the rabbi. By the way, when he answered the question, that rabbi was in Iraq, and he escaped to Italy, and when he got to Italy, there was no Talmud there, and he sat and wrote the entire Talmud. They checked the Talmud, they saw he did not make any mistakes. And he's answering the question. Once we got to 50, I told her, should I continue? There's another 10 pages. More than 100 sources. And this is one out of thousands of questions. And each one of the questions, he answered everything by heart. Even a computer will not be able to answer such a thing. And you telling me this is my hero? Can you compare your hero? Your hero compared to my hero is like comparing a monkey to a person. The Supreme Court chief. What does he know? He doesn't know 1/1,000,000th of the level of this rabbi. But he is unique. Most rabbis, as I say, they have to go and check. No problem. It's perfectly normal. But this is it. So you think all these colleges that people go and spend fortune, what for? Just teach me what I need to be. You want me to be a mechanic? Teach me to be a mechanic. Dentist? I'll be a dentist. Banker? Teach me economy. That's all. Leave me alone with all the rest. Instead of 6 years or 10 years in college, 1 or 2 years, I'll finish everything. I'll be able to become wealthier age 23, 24. I don't have to wait until I'm 30 to start making money and pay my student loans. All corrupted. From the roots. Corruptions. I want to give you another example. When Israel attacked, one little attack in Gaza, after 7,000 missiles are falling on Israel, with no retaliation, one little attack, millions of photographers taking pictures, filming, the whole world against us. United States bombing every hour in Afghanistan, in Iraq, fighting the Taliban, butcher them. Did you ever see one picture from Afghanistan? One picture from Saddam when they went against Saddam? Did you ever see? Not one. They closed everything. Nobody will take pictures here. Why? They're smart. We're not foolish like us. Why it happens to us? The Jews are not dumbs. Why they behave so foolishly? We become blind. We make so many sins, Hashem says. Vayita meshuga mimareh enecha, the Torah says. You become crazy from what you see. Before you digest one tragedy, five already came. Before you know where to start. Sometimes people are calling, I have to convince them not to commit suicide. Why? They have so many problems. They give up on life. I don't want to live. Somebody asked me a year ago, where should I put my money in? Why the stock market is going up? There's nowhere to invest. Real estate, finished. Jewelry, finished. Diamonds, everything finished. Retail, terrible. There's nothing to invest. The person wants to put money to make. The bank gives him 1% interest a year. Where is he going to put his money? So out of desperation, he puts it in the stock market. Like gambling. What is he going to do? That's one of the reasons. Plus, all the people who did short a year or 2 years ago, they knew the market is about to collapse. There's a lot of insiders. Now they must buy it, so it goes up until the next wave will come. So somebody asked me, what should I invest? Guess what I answered? More than a year ago. Invest in Prozac. You know what Prozac is? Anti-depression medicine. I said, Prozac? I said, yes. Every other American is going to take Prozac in a year. You think I'm wrong? Check the statistic. I'm not that far. Almost everybody lives off depression medicine. The kids already get pills. The kid is moving a little bit, ADD, ADD, ADDDD, all kinds of things they have. Take this pill, take this chemical, take this chemical. That's what happened. We as Jews forget one thing. We are the children of the creator of the world. We have Torah, we have Gemara, we have Halacha. Marriage is different by us. Children education is different by us. If we would behave like the Torah says, we wouldn't be affected from all this. Why we suffer today so much? Why? Because we're addicted to the phony life. Take the car away from a Jew. See how depressed he becomes. Why? He has to go on a bus now. It's a death sentence for him. If he'd live according to Torah, you think he care? Car, bus, train, he care, you think? You think he care what food he eats? You think he care about if he went to the shopping mall or not? You think he care about it? The Jews who learn Torah, do you think they care what time of suit they wear? Who cares what suit he's wearing? Someone that his head is empty from spirituality. Someone that is loving Hashem. Someone who connects to the Torah 100%. Someone that is a spiritual person. Do you think he cares what kind of car he drives? It's impossible. The more religious people become, if they really become religious, not phony, just from the outside, really, like the Torah demands, none of these things they care about. You know, I tell you a story. In Mexico, there's a billionaire. He became very rich by buying a television station and sold it for $10 billion. He's a Mexican Syrian Jew. His name is Moshe Sava. Everybody knows him. He wanted to buy a channel in Israel. He's all over the news every week. He's friendly with Rabbi Eliezer Ben David, the cheap Persian rabbi in the whole world. If you ask who is the main Persian rabbi in the whole world, Rabbi Eliezer ben David is in his 70s. He did a lot in his life. He has a lot of institution, organization, shul, yeshivot. He travels. Every country he goes. Very famous. And also an unbelievable speaker. You hear his drashot is very deep. So he used to get from him money for all his colleagues. He has thousands of students who learn Torah, scholars, and Moshe Sava was giving him money, millions of dollars every year, and paid them salary to sit and learn Torah. One person. One time, the rabbi heard that there's a bank in Argentina, before the collapse, that offering 27% interest on your money. He checked if the bank is legit. It's legit. It's a legit bank in Argentina. Like you say in America, Chase, or I don't know, Bank of America. It's a legit bank. Not the biggest, but still. So he said to Moshe Sava, instead of giving me donations, let's open an account on your name. Put $50 million there. 27% of $50 million a year, it's a lot of money. It's more than $10 million a year. It's enough for me to pay all the expenses of all the Talmidim. And you still have your $50 million. It's your money. Sounds good, no? Smart. So Moshe Sava said, no problem. Good idea. He sent the money there. That somebody told me that story. He put the money there. And 3-4 months after, the bank did it because they needed the money. The owners of the bank was planning to take the money and leave the country. Argentina, it's not exactly a stable country. So what happened? All the people held 27% interest. Ran, they put their money there. They took all the money and escaped. And the bank collapsed. The rabbi calls Moshe Sava. I have very bad news to tell you. What happened? The bank disappeared and the $50 million is gone. I checked. There's no way to get it back. And then he was in his 30s. He was very young. He had $150 million. That was his worth net when he found out that he just lost 50. So a third of his money was wiped out in 3 months. Actually, in a moment. Yesterday you had it, today you don't have it. Guess what was his answer? He said, Hashem Natan, Hashem Lakach, Yishem Hashem Evorach. God gave, God took, may God be blessed for everything he does. Don't worry, Rabbi, don't feel bad. I continue to give you what I used to give you before, for donations for the gear guy. I won't leave them alone. Few months after, he found that deal on a television show when it was worth peanuts. Tens of millions, nothing. He bought it, sold it for $10 billion after a few years. You understand? The 20 or 30 or 50 million that it cost him to buy that channel became $10 billion. Do you think it's coincidence? Of course not. Hashem saw what the heart of a Jew. I have so many stories like this. Heart of a Jew. So I'm going to let this Jew down? No. I have to do something for him. I have a guy, I don't want to give too much details because maybe people will know when they listen on a website who I'm talking about. But he's a guy that decided to donate 10,000 DVDs of Torah and Science in one shot. Well, it's $10,000. It's a dollar each in one shot. No. It's a nice donation. I've seen people who receive millions of dollars in one shot, but you know, for today's economy, it's a lot of money. So he gave it. And then 2 months after, his business starting to do bad. He's a doctor, he has a few offices. Customers don't come. Only people who have really emergency, they come. They don't come just because they have something. They don't go to doctors. People suffer, they don't go to doctors. They can't afford. Believe it or not, where we are. So, he told me, listen, I don't understand. Since I became religious, partially, I started to keep mitzvot. I started to finally give donations. Until now, I was doing stupid things with the money. What happened to me? All the businesses are going down. I can't believe it. So I told him, what do you expect? That you give donation and tomorrow you'll be rich? If that will be the case, everyone will give. It's no free choice. No test. You give $1 million, tomorrow you have $2 million. Of course, everybody will do it. Where is the test? The test is that you gave $1 million and 10 years, nothing happens. And 20 years, all of a sudden, you make 10 because you passed the test. If you stole and you lost right away double, it's no test, nobody will steal. Why? 2-3 people stole. Well, I'm crazy to steal. I just saw what happened to someone who steal. 2 minutes later, Rosh Hashanah. Half of the people in the shul were fainting 30 years ago. Not a joke. Check in the history. In Tel Aviv, in Bnei Brak. Here, all this, the old people here, Elul, fainting. Why? If you just got a letter from the IRS, you don't faint? You just got a letter from the FBI that they caught you in an investigation, that they're following you for 5 years, you just found out. You don't faint? You have a trial against the big judge, Hashem, the serious, the judge of all judges. You're not afraid. He's joking. Elul, let's go on a picnic. What did my stock do today? He has a trial. No, today a person has a $100 ticket. When he goes to court, he makes an expense. Just from seeing the flags and all that. The atmosphere of the court makes him nervous. He steals, he speaks Lashon Hara, he touches girls. He does all horrible things with the girls. And he sleeps very well at night. Between hot dog, one hot dog to the other. No Yirat Shamayim. How do you achieve Yirat Shamayim? Only education. Only learning Torah and Musar, ethics, Musar, Mesilat Yesharim, Orchot Tzadikim, Pele Yoetz, Sha'are Tshuva. Many great books. Derech Hashem. Don't learn Musar? What, are you an angel? You don't have Yetzer Hara? What did Hashem say? Barati Yetzer Hara, Barati Torah Tavlin. I created the evil inclination and I gave you the medicine. What is the Torah? No, you don't have time to come to the yeshiva. Turn your internet on. Go into the good website, divineinformation.com. Somebody a little crazy there is talking. He's going to give you some good lectures to wake you up. No? In your bedroom, put your laptop, headphones, let your wife snore. Everybody is snoring already. Take an hour of your time, put your headphones. Every day or other day, listen to 1 hour lecture. Instead of watching all the garbage you're watching every second, put it aside. Give it a trial 1 week. You see how your soul is coming back to life. Remove all the dust and the dirt. I'm reborn. If you see some of the emails the Goyim send me, you wouldn't know where to hide from the embarrassment. We, the Jews. The Goyim, when I get this email, it's like a knife to the heart. Why? Because I'm trying to be honest with myself also, not only with people. First with myself. We are lying constantly and the most to ourselves. That's our main problem. So when I see the Goyim writing me such an email, I say to myself, how can it be I'm so many years religious? I learned Torah. I tried to do well. I give most of my time for the public for free. 99.999% for free. Guaranteed. And I didn't reach the level of this Goy, which is only 2 months in religion. Goy. There is one answer for it. The Goy, the Gentile, don't have evil inclination. You only have Yetzer Hara, evil inclination, for the things that God ordered him to do. But to learn Torah, to become tzaddik like a Jew, he doesn't have resistance. No, no itnagdut. Once they become Jewish, one ton goes on his shoulder. From this moment on, very hard for him. Why? Now you got a Jewish soul. Even the Yetzer Hara began to work. When you're not obligated, the Satan doesn't care you do it. Your reward is very small. Who gets bigger reward? Someone who volunteered to do? He doesn't have to, but he comes on his own to do. And someone that must do, who gets more? You may think someone who volunteered deserves more. He doesn't have to come help. He come, give him more. No. Yes, they deserve more, but there's only one problem. They don't have Yetzer Hara not to come. That's why they can sit and learn Torah all day. Make him a Jew and see tomorrow if he can open a book. You'll be surprised. Everything that he was anxious to do, a second after he comes from the mikveh, becomes very hard. That's a proof that you have Yetzer Hara. Become very hard for them. They become ordinary Jews. They cannot get up in the morning. All of a sudden it's hard for them to learn. All of a sudden, yes, he's attracted to all the girls to make scenes. Before he didn't care so much. This is it, Yetzer Hara. Without the Torah, there's no chance to win the Yetzer Hara. Thank you very much for coming. Good night and all the best. נו, יצא משהו מהערב הזה. קדיש, יש, we have 10 people? רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל, לפיכך הרבה להם תורה ומצוות שנאמר, אדוני חפץ למען צדקו יגדיל תורה ויאדיר. אמן. אמן. אמן, יש מר הבא וברך, אמן, 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 א